Okay.
I tried several times to do when you had a form, I filled it, and I got a copy. It was a carbon copy, you know, and I would get one, and they would keep other at the end. We meet in the middle and say, okay, what's not, like we said it was. But that never happened. So my fear is when I move out, it will be like, oh my goodness, I gave you a pallet. And because who's to say, you know.
Absolutely. Yeah, that I agree.
I'm an attorney for legal aid. So the landlord is allowed to, there's a law that requires them to do this written inspection, and it says that they can adopt their own policy that lets you do it, and then they have 5 days to respond what you submit to them. So I don't know. If I was you, I would argue if they don't do it, if they don't do the written report, they've created a policy where you get to do it, and if you gave it to them and they didn't respond in 5 days,
But I kept it on my own.
If you want to look at, I don't know if you're interested, I can give you the Virginia Code, or I can write it down for you. I'm so glad Kim jumped in. I wanted to introduce you, but I was like, I didn't know if she wanted to be introduced. So Kim, can you scroll through about the code number though? Sure, I can just give, so if people, again, I don't think the law is that, a lot of times it's easy to read on your own and to understand. So it's just Virginia Code 55-248.11:1, and that's the whole part of the code that deals with inspection when you move in.
Feel free to jump in. I'm excited. So, absolutely. So, your security deposit. Like I mentioned earlier, it should not be more than 2 months worth of rent when you're moving out. It should not take more than 45 days for the landlord to get it back to you. If he does, basically, if he doesn't give you the full amount back, there needs to be an itemized list of deductions. So if you pay $500 and you only get $300 back, there needs to be a reason why. There needs to be some documentation as to the condition of the apartment, as to what it was. Now this can get a little tricky. A lot of times this is where a lot of landlords and tenants clash as far as the condition, the move out condition of the apartment. So if the landlord is not returning your security deposit, we encourage you to call legal aid or any type of legal assistance. So requesting repairs, this is what y'all always talk about, right?
Now, I had a question on that.
Oh, I'm sorry, go ahead.
The lease, once you say you leave, and then, like, okay, here, I got a previous experience, and, you know, this is almost current. My brother moved out, and he didn't get his security deposit. These apartments are come and live. And you said if any damages have been done, you got to get a list of damages to get your money. Like, tell them why you didn't get your money. Nothing. You got nothing. Just he was told, he was supposed to put in his that he was leaving 6 months in advance.
Okay.
He
put in notice 4 months in advance.
Before he left.
Okay.
So I think we're going to talk about that later on. So save that question. Yeah. Because that's really specific. So. Write them down. Like I said, this presentation is going to generate questions of why something didn't happen the way it was supposed to happen. Always write a request and send it certified mail. And we encourage this even if there's an email system or a phone system, know who you're talking to. So if you call a secretary and say, my dishwasher's not working, know who you talk to, get a name, number, anything like that, and just keep a paper trail. You'll always hear me say this, to keep a paper trail. A lot of times, too much stuff is just done verbally, and so things can get miscommunicated. So when you keep your track record, whether it's your lease or writing down your repairs, there's no discrepancy over what happened. So definitely, even with the system, the phone, email, anything like that, write your request down and send a certified mail. The reason we say certified mail is because a landlord cannot say they didn't receive it because they have to sign off saying that they received that piece of mail.
Okay.
To send something certified mail, that would take 2 buses for us to get to the post office from here. Mm-hmm. So that would be a little difficult. So what are the other options that we have? Because what the residents are finding is that they will call time and time again, and we have on-site maintenance, and they will tell them time and time again. So eventually everyone just gives up, and they understand that they're being disregarded, and, you know, they just don't end up calling anymore. So they also have, like, an online system where you can submit tickets online, and that, I guess that may be sufficient notice, but everyone doesn't have computers and internet and stuff to be able to do it like that. So what options do people have to keep the track record?
Can you put your hand up?
Yeah, we run it. So certified mail is expensive and sometimes hard for folks to do. So a workaround we've had people do is take a picture of yourself putting the envelope in the mailbox, if you're dropping it in a blue mailbox, and get a date stamp on the picture you take, or have your cell phone be able to record what date you took the picture and then just drop it in. Okay. And then if the landlord claims you didn't mail it, there's like, for lawyers, like, there's like a rebuttable presumption that mail gets to where you sent it, right? So if you can prove that you mailed it, then it's on the landlord to prove that you get it.
So should they also take a picture of what's inside,
item?
Yeah, cameras are awesome. Like, right?
They are. They really do that. Yeah. The whole camera is a good thing. Yeah, I tell my clients at home all the time too. You know, when I need a signature on something, they'll text me a picture of it. So.
To go along their point, one of the things that's been held by the courts routinely is if you mail it first class mail and you can prove that you put it in the mailbox and it never comes back and you have the right address on it, it's considered delivered. It's one of the things that we deal with when we're doing it, because we'll send both certified and first class in a lot of cases, because sometimes we'll often send the first class with not being on city letterhead or city envelope. Because sometimes, you know, when we send something out, the person who's receiving it knows it's not good. So, my name's John Walsh, operations manager, code enforcement. But what happens is they'll reject the certified letter, but the handwritten, just plain envelope, oftentimes they'll accept, not really knowing what it is. Well, once they open it, then it's a little harder to sort of send it back and say they didn't see it. So the courts have generally held that as long as you can prove you mailed it and it's got the proper address, it'll be considered delivered.
Well, if I ask myself, I have actually went to PRS Holdings and actually requested services done by writing to the secretary. I have also talked to, I guess it was head of maintenance. Also, you know, and a lot of times, well, one other time, they have started on something and it never really got finished. Mm-hmm. And the last request that I have had was the fact that I have had mold, bed bugs, and mice in my home. And nothing has been done about it. I talked to the maintenance man. He comes and he doesn't come back, you know. I have a leaky faucet underneath my sink. I have pictures. I've shown these pictures and everything, you know, and nothing has been done. I was forced to write a request saying that I did not want my lease renewed. And with the fact that I really don't have another place to go, I don't really have the money up for the deposit or anything, because they have the deposit for the home that I'm in now. And when I gave them my money, I gave it to them in cash, you know, and they don't even want to consider the fact that I asked them, well, is it possible that they can remove me from the apartment that I'm in now.
You wanted a transfer.
You know, I wanted a transfer, and they're giving me all this BS, all this runaround and things, and my bills is steadily climbing because of the heat, you know, and I'm paying for mice that should not be in my home. I bought 12 in the last 2 weeks.
What?
So, and it's unacceptable. I don't have a name.
unacceptable.
And here it's almost April. I have to June to either try to find a place or also, and they still have okay to try to address none of my problems. These bed bugs, my granddaughter, she is allergic to insects, period. So I have to spend money on doctor fees, medication. They sent someone out to do a treatment, and the man did a treatment once. This was in December, and he told me that I have to live out of really my kitchen, everything I have to be in my kitchen, and in my bathroom. I have kids, 2 weeks of that. That is unacceptable.
Yes, it is.
You know,
yes, it is.
Unacceptable. I've thrown away clothes. I've thrown away furniture, everything. You know, I have bags of receipts that I have bought this 99% alcohol. I've spent $300 on this to try to keep them down on myself. And, you know, that's just unacceptable. 1 month, I told them that I had to be late paying my rent because I had to buy this stuff, you know. And I have pictures. They refuse to come out and do it. I'm trying to figure out where these mice are coming from. I have pictures to show where they have taken out the cabinet in my kitchen. But it's a big old hole gaping. What they did was just threw some on top of it. And you can actually hear when those critters eat to come through it.
Yeah.
You actually can hear that. My granddaughter plays with them things in the wall, talks to them. That's unacceptable.
Yeah. Yes.
You know, I didn't want to raise your rent. You know, and I'm not sure what to do. I'm not sure what to do about that. I'm not sure how to go about it. I'm not sure, you know, I'm trying to find another place for us to go in this time frame. But I really feel as if some of this should be on them.
Yeah.
Yes, it should. Yes, it should.
To go through all of this. I can see if I wasn't paying my rent. I can see if I wasn't taking care of the apartment or so. But the problem was Jack when I got it. Mm. I understand it was a cheaper apartment, so I had to try to keep it up myself. But I've done so, you know. And the maintenance man, I understand he's only one person, and he has so much. When he comes, the man doesn't come back. Or whatever, I have a brand new cabinet. And water just leaks. Yep. I mean, I spent so much money
Like what?
Let me ask a question. Has anybody tried putting their rent into escrow or tenant assistance?
I
went to them twice myself. And the day that I told them, I had my counselor with me, and the day that I was actually going to do it, because it was on the 4th that I had to pay the rent, mm-hmm. which I'm always prompt and panic, they sent someone out to start the job. So mm-hmm. that stopped me from putting it in escrow.
Yeah,
and once I started it,
yeah, they
didn't come
they
back
follow
and
it.
Finish it. And, you know, at all. You know,
that's why
they've been holding that in my bathroom, and the mold just steadily comes. They tell me what sprays bleach. I sprays the bleach, but it just steadily comes back.
That's
you know,
why I brought Tim here from
and
we also have I also am in contact with a pro bono attorney. She's going to work with us for free. They work at a law firm in Richmond. So they're going to be coming by to help everybody put their money in the escrow and everything. So just make sure you got a copy of your lease so that when Kim is ready to work with you and Ray, that's her name, the other lawyer that's going to work with us when they're ready, you got to have your lease ready. So make sure you request a copy of your lease.
I put in for a request to move because they say you have to do this before time. It's almost April now, so to give a say, my lease is probably up June the 6th. So that means I'm going to have to pay my rent and plus try to find
to
money to move. And that's just unacceptable. It shouldn't have to be like this.
The escrow is really, it's really hard and it's really not fair, and I wish it wasn't Virginia law, but you have to, the law is that if you stop paying your rent, your landlord can evict you.
I don't have a problem with paying.
No, I understand, but I'm saying it's frustrating when you are renting a place for $600 and it's not worth what... It's not worth $600 because they're not making repairs. But if you hold the rent money, like because they're not making repairs, they can evict you. So that's what Granny's talking about with the escrow.
Escrow, that's protection.
I would rather put it in the escrow account, but to see that, being that I'm really trying to move, because I don't think they're gonna come in and actually do what they supposed to do. I probably have less than 2 months.
It's sad that she thinks that.
Less than 2 months.
It's sad that she actually thinks that nobody's going to protect her.
I have to throw away three beds, you know. But besides the fact that I have to pay my rent to stay, I have to save up money to move, and plus get the things that I have to throw away. These things are expensive. I don't get assistance from the state or whatever. I have to work for everything that I have. Who's gonna pay for that money when I see these bugs come from out the wall?
So I'm definitely not saying tax assertions are perfect. They're really not. But one of the things the court can order is that you escrow your rent. So it's paid $600 each month. The court can order some of that given back to you at the end if the landlord find that there are problems in the apartment. But I think that even if the landlord starts making repairs, right, it might still be a good idea. I mean, I think it's still a good idea to go to court.
Yeah.
The judge can continue the case out, which means set it out later and make the landlord come back and prove that they completed.
Exactly.
Right? So that's a good way to keep
a good idea
over the landlord. Yeah. And then you can say what you just said, to be like, it's not fair that while I was waiting for you to do pest control, I paid however much money to take care of this. I should get the rent money back. I should get all of it back.
I'm trying to get them personally to contact me to answer some of my phone calls, because I said, well, maybe if you can transfer me, help me to find somewhere better, you should be able to use my deposit to put me into somewhere better. They don't want to do that. They want me to pay them another deposit and pay for the first month's rent, and then get my deposit back in 4 or 5 days.
The escrow idea is a good idea.
Can we do this? I think that it's important that we understand what is the process that you go through to put your money into an escrow.
That's right, Ellen. That's right.
That's the first thing. If you're not moving, and that is the option that is available to you, but we need to understand what that process is, what rights you have as related to setting up the escrow account. Even if we all need assistance in helping to make that happen, but let's understand what that process is. Mm-hmm. And don't be misled by someone telling you you can't do it.
Right.
Let's understand what that
right.
is.
Right.
And that's
going to
be a tie to That's My Next
Live. Real quick, we did have someone else that was managed by property by KRS University on the north side last year, and she did put her money in escrow, and she got like $1,000 back when she wanted. They hadn't cut her grass, and it was a whole lot of stuff going on. She rents a house over north side from Great Richmond. So don't think that you can't get your money back. You might still have to pay it to the court, but when they make their ruling, you can get money back.
Right.
You got to have a good understanding of
it. You don't have to pay. There's another form.
You have to pay the court $50 every month. First to the fifth to put your rent money in the escrow account.
That fee can be waived.
Twice.
That fee will be waived.
I tried it twice. I have the rent money, but don't have escrow a fee. And
that's when that person can get what you want done taken.
Right, because without that protection, you just left.
Let's go through the process. And then she goes through indicate what you've experienced differently, okay? Like the $50 if you'll pay.
Yeah.
But it probably can be waived.
It can be waived.
It can be waived.
So if you take out the yellow sheet in your folder, that's a copy of the tenant's assertion and complaint. And on the back side are directions, and I'll kind of touch on what needs to happen. So once again, just take note, if it didn't happen like this, so let's see here. So the court can order, so basically what you can do, put your written down for it. Basically what that means is, and I'm going to jump to page 10 in the PowerPoint. So what you can do is find the appropriate court to file in. That could be Richmond City General District Court in Wrightville County, Chesterfield, wherever your property that you're renting is located.
I think it's the John Marshall Court Building.
Or John Marshall, thank you. And basically you're going to submit this tenant's assertion form. So once again, this is one of those things where you want to get someone to help you out to fill this out properly. And so be prepared to show receipts of on-time rent payments, confirmation that your landlord received the notice you sent. So this is where I think, you know, where I keep on saying keep that paper trail, keep a paper trail record of all the times you've asked for repairs and they haven't been met. That's going to help. So when you submit your tenant's assertion, you can show that you did your due diligence. This is like your last resort. So that's the importance of, like Kim was saying, taking a cell phone, pictures and everything like
just
that.
Just really quick, I just wanted to clarify the confirmation of the that I noticed that I sent, not notifying my landlord that I filed an assertion, confirmation or notices that I've complained several times before.
Mm-hmm.
Okay, just to make sure, because I was wondering if I needed to let them know that I'm going to claim, because last time I did, it's the same thing. Someone came out and started it, and here we are. It's never been.
I was told.
So
yeah. And that's important too, because I heard a lot of y'all say that it's partial repairs. I think that's really important to document in all of, whenever you do the tenants as a group or as individuals, is that that's how they're getting over on the whole tenant assertion system.
Correct.
Is they're starting it so that way it's boxed out.
Yeah.
So document that in your paperwork, you know, that they started it and they didn't finish it. I heard several of y'all say that.
I have one business meeting.
Yeah.
And he's trying to do everything.
Mm-hmm.
And this man is sending him Southside,
mm-hmm.
Chesterfield, and everywhere. And he can't do it all. But
yeah.
This is what he wants to do, the maintenance man. Because I think he's trying to get all the money for himself.
Yeah. And then make some of them. So is he logging it in? Like, you know, saying it's completed?
That's right.
Yeah.
Because see, before this man took over, we had a maintenance group. But they were farmers. But they knew them. They did their best, but they didn't do what was required. But they did their best. They did better than this maintenance man doing, and this owner is doing.
Mm-hmm.
But they did fix some things when you complain. But now,
go ahead.
Just, and please, I'm not trying to sidetrack me at all.
Yeah.
But let me make a clarification too on some of the things that are happening here that might help you all. There's a lot of frustration with KRS. Okay, here's the problem with the way this set of units are set up. KRS is not handling your maintenance. KRS is simply taking the report, and the maintenance guy works directly for the owner. KRS in other places will actually do the maintenance, but here under this particular owner who owns this particular set of apartments, all KRS does is serve as the reporting agency. They are not responsible for any of the repairs.
So I'm a little confused because... let me ask my question.
The owner of the property has hired his own maintenance man to then take those reports from KRS and perform...
I understand that. So what I'm saying, though, is that when we deal with the property management, we don't have a relationship with the owner. So the property, however they deal with that internally with the maintenance, we deal with the property management. That's who we would take to court. So I don't want them to be confused by what you're saying, thinking that they have to go talk to some separate
person.
Well,
actually, you won't take KRS to court because they don't have the authority to do
it.
They are the ones.
The problem is with the owner.
So your tenant assertion should go to the owner of where you live, not the property management.
In this case, I believe that, now let the attorney answer that, but in this case, I believe that would be correct.
If you put that money in escrow, it'll get the owner's attention.
But
yeah.
Under whom?
It'll get the owner's attention. If you put that money in escrow,
we have the lease.
He'll probably travel here to Richmond to talk to you.
Property management company. We don't deal with the owner.
Right. KRS takes those reports, and then by the terms of their contract with the owner, their only responsibility is to turn those reports over.
Yes, okay, that's however they determine that in turn. I don't want you to confuse people thinking that they have to go find the owner or something. They don't have to. We deal with the property manager.
Turn it into the report.
We deal with the property manager.
But y'all have a more complicated system than a lot of other.
So what's the.
That's on your end. The complication is on your end, and I don't want you to put that off on the owner.
It's not on our end.
No, because they told me that they were just the.
Yeah,
what's called the.
They're the middleman. And I get that. So what's the solution? Now, that's what I want to
know. Escrow account.
But to whom? To KRS or to.
Take that money to John Marshall Court Building.
I haven't seen your lease, but who sued you if you don't pay your rent?
KRS.
KRS.
I would sue KRS.
Exactly.
I would sue KRS, and if they want to appear in court.
If they want to pass the buck, then they can pass the buck.
Then I would let them do that. I would sue KRS. But I also haven't seen your lease, right?
Mm-hmm. So, yeah.
I would be happy to look at someone's lease, but I think it's a good rule of thumb that whoever sues you.
Because anything we receive in the mail comes from them. That from the man. Now, when I had the problem with my kitchen counter and the maintenance man came out, he didn't have to call KRS though. He called the person that owned it, and I told him that wasn't coming back into my home, that I needed to have a brand new kitchen countertop. So I didn't have to call KRS Holding for that. And he did, he went ahead on and he put that in, but they didn't do the work sufficiently. They didn't, because one led to another. That's the rodents that I got because they didn't do it right.
How about Amari? You can send me your lease or someone else's lease, mm-hmm. and I'll look at it and I'll let Amari know what the way things.
She has her lease right here. She got her lease right here.
If I could ask you a question, is it possible to get the lease between the owner and the maintenance person, or the owner and KRS? Is it public information? Because what I'm hearing is the manager, the owner,
I'm here now.
Have everybody going in circles.
Mm-hmm.
So KRS is being, they have been sort of not only the middleman, but the whipping boy, but they don't have the level of authority to make some of the decisions that need to be made. As relates to these clients or residents. So how do we find out how that protocol rolls down so we can know who do we really go after?
So I would say, without having a chance to sit down and look at a lot of documents, I would litigate a tenant assertion and make them come in. And if they think that it's like, so in the past, sometimes, and I'm not sure, I'll sue all three people, like all three of them, and I'll let them come in and be like, no, it's not me, it's that person, and then sort it out, right?
But I think because
the tenant assertion is a way to make them all show up, and someone's accountable, right?
He in the escrow.
Yeah.
When they miss that money, they'll come out the woodworks.
And let me say here, I'm not defending KRS. We've had plenty of cases with KRS. Okay, I'm not trying to defend them as this great management company, because y'all have all read the paper. You know we've had them in a lot of cases and in court in a lot of times. But the simple fact is, this is a uniquely complicated set of sort of circumstances. The way they have structured this deal makes it even difficult for us sometimes to sort of figure out where we're going and who we're pursuing. So it's It's not the ideal way of setting up a relationship for tenants. It's just, and that's what I'll say to that.
Okay, I have one question left for y'all, because I do have to go to court to pay for all this mess, but go to work, I mean. But who here can actually help me with my situation? Who here can actually count on to make sure that I've told everyone here my problem, that I can go to at least start to help myself?
Escrow.
Anybody here got any idea
escrow
or
account.
Anything to what I can do, yeah, as far as me having to live in these conditions, as far as me having to move, as far as me having this time frame?
Let me address that. I'm sorry. I'm not trying to sidetrack your presentation. I'm really not.
Yeah.
But let me say this. All of the things that you have talked about are things that we either have state code or local ordinance to deal with. Okay? But in order for us to deal with that, I need you to call our office and file a complaint. And then we have to come to your apartment and do the inspection, look at all the conditions, write a report. Now, I'm going to tell you from the tenant's assertion standpoint and putting your stuff in escrow, if you're holding a report from the government that says your apartment is in violation of these codes, it makes this process a lot easier. Because now you have instant credibility in the court. The judge says,
right.
And what happens, and I've seen these, we've been in court where these things came through, where a tenant just went on their own, and one of the questions the judge asks, especially if you're in a locality that has a maintenance code, have you reported it to the city?
Good.
And what will happen is, there are cases where they will continue it until you report to the city or things of that nature. So what you need to do is contact our office, and we'll leave some cards and some numbers and provide you some information. That's one thing I noticed on the list of all those phone numbers, we're not on it. So, yeah, we need to change that.
Right, give
it out right now. Give it out
right now. I'm gonna leave some cards.
You to help me to get this on to get this
right.
Right.
Now the second question.
This is for the maintenance of.
That's for the maintenance part.
Okay.
That's what I'm saying.
Right.
This is for the maintenance part.
The second part is to do the escrow.
I'm gonna leave some cards. I'm gonna give you our number, and then I'm gonna try to let her get back on track. Our office number.
So we can have one person talking so that everybody can hear what's going on. It's really, really important.
Okay, let me give you our office number so that if you have a complaint, you can call us. We need a complaint from somebody who lives and has legal access to the property. Okay? The number is 646-6398. That's 646-6398. Obviously it's 804, I didn't say it. We all know it's 804. So,
and this is Richmond bit?
That's the city of Richmond. In fact, we're located right at City Hall.
Mm-hmm.
Not far from here at all. So we have an inspector who's dedicated to this area, and we can, a code inspector, and we can certainly help you with those things. But we've got to get the complaint from you as the tenant. I need for you as the tenant to complain to us. We will typically call you back or schedule an appointment within about 48 hours.
After calling.
After contact. Unless it's an emergency. You call us up and it's 20 degrees and say my heat's out, we have after hour guys, they'll come out that night and take a look at it and do that sort of stuff.
And
they took less than 24 hours to come out to me. In the 2 months that I was dealing with property management, I called code enforcement, and he called me back less than 12 hours later and came to my house 2.5 hours later.
Mm.
And the very next day, I had a copy. I had never, like, this. I want to make a Facebook page just so people know. I had no idea. Like, I even went to see a lawyer. And
right.
Up until the free time ended, and I felt lost. But less than 24 hours later, he had my copy taken. taped to my door. So I also have a copy of what the owner is saying. From you, I'm so glad you told me that.
John Wilton and I, John Wilton and I are going to stay till the end of the presentation, but I really want to let her get back on track.
Okay. Make the complaint and do the escrow account. It goes in hand in hand.
We want to go step by step, okay? Because there are certain things you can, need to do, you can do at the same time, okay? So if you already have a long list of complaints that you've been making to with whoever for a period of time, you still need to call the city.
Yes.
Okay? Because this list that we got here, they can't use somebody else sending you a list in. They have to get a call from the person who lives there, the tenant that lives there, in order for them to come into your property.
We've got
to
have someone who will access.
They will let, you can let them in to do the inspection, okay?
So out contact, yes.
Yes. Out, yes. But you can also make this, do this process, but you can start working on your court.
Yes.
Escrow account.
There's a lot of information that you need to put together.
Show number, so that you can help me decide on the, oh, it's in here, okay, decide on the escrow account.
Yeah, actually, it's going to be legal aid, you have my card.
I have a question.
Yeah.
So being that you having this issue with being able to get into people's apartments because they weren't the ones that filed the complaint, although I told you, you know, everyone's unit number for you to go to, what is it that I can do as somebody that lives in the community to assist you guys with your job in doing that? Because I know that it was recommended that you guys work with volunteers from the community to take the burden off of you guys back in 2010, so I'm not sure what happened with those recommendations for the city auditor.
Right, I believe we can come up with a strategy.
Well, actually, I'm trying to help code enforcement, so.
Yeah, let me just very briefly.
Anything that I can do to help you do your job?
Certainly, anything that community activists or neighbors want to do to help each other, support each other, help them, you know, figure out what they need to do and what they don't need to do, provide them with information. The issue with us, and where it really becomes an issue with us, is that ultimately these are criminal court cases that we have to gather evidence for. So we have to, there's a certain chain of custody that we've got to create and controls. We can't use other people's information necessarily in a court case.
Okay.
And so we need to be able to come out and do the inspection, actually physically see the violation, make a note of it, take our own pictures, and gather that case. Create what is a criminal court file. And then if we end up having to go to court, we can attest to all of our evidence.